Bom dia a todos. Nós vamos reiniciar as atividades aqui na IASH USP Leste em relação à Escola Avançada de Educação Física, Fisioterapia, Fonoaudiologia e Terapia Ocupacional, que teve apoio da Pró-Reitoria de Pesquisa da USP, avisando a todos que estão nos assistindo online, os aqui presentes, para olhar na página do Facebook Escola Avançada de Educação Física. Essa é uma iniciativa da Pró-Reitoria de Pesquisa, que envolve os programas de pós-graduação da área 21. E, além do professor Joseph Hammer, teremos mais 12 pesquisadores envolvidos nesse programa que virão para o Brasil para ministrar palestras, fazer reunião com os alunos e desenvolver a pesquisa aqui na Universidade de São Paulo. Joe, thank you very much again for coming. It's going to be very nice to hear from you, and we are looking forward to your presentation.
When I was asked to come to São Paulo this time, Luis Mochizuki said, I would like you to speak about these topics. And this is one of the topics that he wanted me to speak about. And basically, in this talk, what I'm going to try and do is explain the difference between linear and nonlinear dynamics and clear up these particular terms: variability, stability, complexity, and adaptability. In many of the recent publications, these terms are used interchangeably, but they're not the same thing, and that's what I'm going to try and explain to you today. And what has happened over many, many years, the traditional biomechanics was always done with linear mathematics. Now, one of the things that you should know is that the human body is absolutely nonlinear in every sense of the word, but we use linear mathematics. And of course, linear mathematics are a lot easier than nonlinear mathematics. So, we know that all of the behaviors and all of the tissue act nonlinearly in the human system. So, what we have to do then is use nonlinear methods based on a dynamical systems approach. You'll often see this referred to as dynamical systems theory. Same thing. And it's become more relevant, especially in biomechanics. It's always been relevant in motor control, but not as much in biomechanics. But now it's being used a great deal. So, this new approach, or the dynamical systems approach, it gives you an insight into how people maintain pattern stability, how people transition from one state to another state, and how we are governed by long and short-term correlational processes, or fractal processes, in different spatiotemporal scales. This is the basic thrust. Now, actually, I want to go back because I forgot to mention my colleagues, Richard Van Emmerich, who's a professor at the University of Massachusetts, and two of his graduate students that I also work with very closely, Scott Ducharme and Avelino Amaro. So, I'm going to talk about an introduction to nonlinear methods first. As I said, biomechanics, as you probably know it, and as I started off, was completely linear, and that's what we looked at. And the problem with linear methods is it lacks the fidelity to fully explore what we would call the richness of the movement. What I found out when I started using nonlinear dynamics, when I would analyze a study using linear methods, I would find no differences. As soon as I started looking at nonlinear dynamics, I would start finding differences in the parameters. And that led me to fully explore nonlinear dynamics much more fully. And this comes down to what we could talk about, a dynamical system. And it's very simple. It's one that evolves over time. not only does it evolve over time, it can change over time. You know, linear methods can't do that. And I'll try and explain that to you a little bit later. So, if we look at dynamical systems perspective, it focuses on how systems evolve over time. Okay? And what you get in these nonlinear systems is that there are abrupt changes that occur. And we can look at that, at these abrupt changes. So, linear methods interpret the structure of data through linear correlations. You know, most of you probably used a Pearson product moment correlation. That's a linear correlation. Okay? And the implication of this is that the intrinsic dynamics of the system are governed by the fact that small changes in the system result in small effects. And the thing about linear equations, and these are very simple equations, the only thing that they can do is show you an increase, a decrease, or a steady state. That's all they can do. And I've used these three very simple diagrams. So this is a linear system. It could be. And this is a decrease, an increase, and a steady state. Okay? You cannot get any changes in these systems. So let me show you. I'm going to use a very simple equation, linear equation, right here. And this is often used for population of animal species growth. It's not very complicated at all. So you have, this is the current state of the system, N sub I. This is the new state of the system, and R is some parameter that when you multiply it by N sub I, it gives you the new state of the system. So what you basically find is that R can take a value here, and that means that the system is getting smaller. That's that growth, like, in this direction. If R is greater than 1, okay, the system is getting larger. And if R equals 1, well, you can see very simply that R 1 times N sub I equals this. There's going to be no change. That's all you can do with a linear system. So, here we have the decay. Here we have the growth, and here we have the steady state, or stable state. Nonlinear systems, however, are completely governed in human behavior. All human behavior is nonlinear. And I've given an example here is tissue tendons. They show nonlinear characteristics in response to a stretch. So this is the stress or the force applied to the system. This is an elongation, okay? If it was, any tendon was linear, it would look like this. However, what the stress strain curve for a tendon actually looks like this. And that is a nonlinear system, okay? If you look here, you could get a stiffness of the system here and the stiffness of the system there. Here, you only get one stiffness. Okay, so you all understand the difference now between a linear and a nonlinear system. The nonlinear methods are a little bit more complicated. So, and I'm going to use the same example, but here we have now a nonlinear system, and you can see this is the current state, this is the next state of the system, and you have these parameters here, R and B. Okay? And R and B can vary independently of each other, and because they can do that, okay, the system can change nonlinearly. And the way we do this is we actually substitute this value here, x, for the parameters b times n sub I divided by r. And this is what we get, is a nonlinear system. Okay? You notice the difference in the equations. Now, this system here is often referred to as a logistic equation or a quadratic map. Quadratic just means nonlinear. Okay. So, in this logistic map or quadratic map, we can observe steady state, we can observe bifurcations. So, bifurcation means a split in the system, going, I could go this way or it could go that way. And it also will demonstrate chaotic dynamics. Okay. So, now we have a picture of what a nonlinear system looks like. And the thing is, these bifurcations, different system dynamics, all occur as a function of R, how R changes. Now, you should note that chaotic dynamics emerge in deterministic systems as well, in which future states should be formally predictable, but where uncertainty in the initial conditions impacts the future states. Okay. So what you get in initial conditions can impact much further down the line. But human movement systems are not governed by deterministic dynamics at all. And what they're more likely to present is stochastic behaviors. Stochastic simply means random behaviors. And these are governed by probabilities of states that can be impacted by deterministic and random processes. So you can get both things working. Whereas in the linear system, you only get one thing that's working. So, you know, by understanding these two systems, we can see that there are many, many physiological processes that work non-linearly. Any kind of biological tissue, muscle, tendon, ligament, bone, they all act non-linearly. Human behavior certainly acts non-linearly. And human movement acts non-linearly as well. So, as I said before, dynamical systems focuses on how systems maintain their current state in relation to stability, change or transition between states, variability and adaptability, and regulate complexity or fractal dynamics characterized by interactions across spatiotemporal scales. Keep in mind that linear dynamics cannot address any of these. This is the one here, the change in transition between states. The one that is often looked at, and in our laboratory we've looked at too, is the transition from walking to running. You know, there's a distinct transition, and things occur when you transition from walking to running. So, what we're going to do in this presentation is compare and contrast the concepts variability, stability, complexity, and how these impact movement adaptability. Just keep in mind, variability, stability, and complexity are not the same thing. Even though, I guarantee you, if you went to the literature now, you would find a number of papers that will talk about complexity when they really mean variability, or variability when they really mean stability. So let's start off with variability. And everyone thinks that this is the easiest thing to talk about. And it's always been defined from a statistical point of view. People use standard deviation. That is a measure of variability. Okay. You know, well, actually, it's often talked about variance, which is simply the square of the standard deviation. But variability of performance may not simply be additive in the form of measurement noise, but actually is part of the signal. And this is the thing that differentiates variability from just the statistical process. What you would find in the literature previously, if you use linear methods, you'll find people will calculate, let's say, an angle, and they will look at the standard deviation of the angle. And the larger the standard deviation, they would say, indicates, and it does, indicate the variability of that angle. But what does that variability mean? So, if we look at physiological variability, or the actual variability from iteration to iteration of a movement, we can write these equations and we can show what they are. Here's a simple function. You have some function. This is the present state of the system. This is the next state of the system. Okay? But contained in that, you have this parameter mu sub n. Mu sub n refers to the measurement noise. Now, I'm sure you've all taken data and put some kind of digital filter or smoothing to get rid of measurement noise. Okay? And you can get rid of that. But within the signal itself is this parameter called beta sub n. And beta sub n refers to the biological variability. Okay. Now you're probably asking, what is biological variability? Let me give you a very simple example. After the talk today, you should go and get a piece of paper and write your name. And write it 10 times. And what you will notice is you will never write it exactly the same. You will write it slightly differently every time. That's biological variability. Okay? So contained in every signal in biomechanics, you will have measurement variability, but you will also have biological variability. Measurement variability, you can get rid of most of it by smoothing the data. What's left in terms of variability is the biological variability. And that becomes very important. So, while variability is widely used for all sources of variation, the meaning of variability must be understood in the context of the measurement. You have to understand what the measurement is. So, we've basically referred to two different kinds of variability. I'm not talking about measurement variability at all. I'm talking about this biological variability. And we have talked about two different kinds of biological variability. One, we talk about endpoint variability. And the second we talk about is coordinative variability. So, what is endpoint variability? Well, let's say in football, you're taking a penalty kick. The goal of the penalty kick is actually to put the ball in the net. You would like that done every time. So let's say you scored 10 goals, or let's say you scored 9 goals out of 10 attempts. You have variability within that. Okay? That's endpoint variability. The goal should have very small variability. Coordinative variability, however, is how the performance was conducted over a number of times. Okay. In other words, you may not kick the ball exactly the same way every time. The result may be the same, but how you actually accomplish the task may be different. That's coordinated variability. How the segments orient themselves to create variability. Now, in our laboratory, I wrote a paper in 1999 actually to try to explain this, And it was not very well received at the time. Now it's very common knowledge that endpoint variability should be very small. Okay? The goal of the task, the variability should be small. You should score 9 times or 10 times out of 10 on a penalty kick. Coordinative variability, on the other hand, if you're a skilled performer, should be large. You should have a number of ways of doing the same task. So, let's start off with endpoint variability. And this is the traditional focus of variability. It's easy to measure, okay? You know, I mean, all you have to do is assign a task, and the more they succeed in the task, the variability will be lower. You know, an example that I will give, I'll show you in a second. In pistol shooting, keeping the barrel gun aimed precisely at the target with little or no variability is essential. You know, if I'm going to shoot a pistol, I want to make sure that the end point of the gun doesn't move, because then the goal will be achieved with very little variability. But when I have low endpoint variability, the higher the level of the task performance is not necessarily accompanied by low variability at the level of the coordination. So this is a very famous study. It was performed in 1969 by Aruchinen. And he looked at experienced and novice pistol shooters. And what he found was that the endpoint variability was less in experienced shooters. That's exactly what you would expect. These were Olympic caliber shooters, actually. But what he found was the shoulder, elbow, wrist coordinative variability was higher in the experienced shooters. On one hand, endpoint was low, coordination variability was high. And so the endpoint indicates the steadiness of the pistol barrel. Coordinative indicates the interactions of the various joints. Okay? So the two different kinds of variability. And the problem is, in biomechanics, for many years, people thought endpoint variability and coordinative variability were the same thing. And that's because they were using linear systems. Now, coordinative variability, we believe, is essential in producing movement patterns that are adaptable. That's the key thing, a movement pattern that is adaptable. In other words, if I'm throwing a baseball or throwing a ball, I can do it like that, I can do it like that, I can do it like that. I could accomplish the same goal by doing all three of those things. I have movement variability, coordinative variability. Now, all of this was first proposed, not by anyone in the United States. It was Nikolai Bernstein, and he proposed most of this in the 1930s. And so he was in the Soviet Union. And what happened was a lot of his writings were lost, and they were never really published in, I think, until 1968 or something like that. And that's when people in the West discovered this whole notion of variability and dynamical systems. And Bernstein suggested that the same task may be accomplished using different degrees of freedom. And what he meant by degrees of freedom is a number of individual components. And these individual components can be muscles, joints, or segments, and all that are available to complete a task. So you have a number of ways of doing the same task, and that is coordinative variability. And so the multiple degrees of freedom within the human system, this is what allows us to perform the task in multiple different ways. And coordinative variability is also associated with higher levels of endpoint variability are evidenced in poor task performance. So, in a poor performance, you could have low coordinated variability and low endpoint variability. You know, so even, and you could actually have high coordinated variability and low endpoint variability. And of course, you could have combinations of such. This is a study that we did in one of my students, Christine Pollard. And what we had in this was a situation where we had males and females, and the task that they had to accomplish was a cutting maneuver. And it was unanticipated. So they had to approach a forest platform at 6.5 meters per second running. And then if a light came on and said, don't do anything, just go straight ahead, a light would come on and say, stop. So they had to stop immediately, and a light came on and do cut. The performer did not know which one they were doing until 1 meter before the forest platform. Now remember, they were running at 6.5 meters per second. And what we looked at was a combination, or a coupling, of, in this case, thigh rotation and leg rotation. Now, this is the point here, and this is a cutting maneuver. This is a point here where they actually made the cut. So the foot went down, and at the point where they started to move, that happened here about 40% of stance. And you notice there's a significant difference between females and males. Okay? And what this indicates, the higher variability in the males means that they had more degrees of freedom being utilized, or they could use more degrees of freedom than what the females could do. And one of the things that we know, that females are more likely to have an ACL injury. And so we related lower coordinative variability to a pathology, or the potential for a pathology. So, what we said was healthy would be have a high coordinative variability. Now, if you decrease the coordinative variability, you're injured, or you have a potential for injury. On the other hand, if you have increasingly high coordinative variability, you can also become injured because the variability is too high. The trick is, in all of this, is knowing where this healthy window of variability is. And I can tell you right now, I have no clue where that is. I don't know. So, this is the big problem. Variability is used synonymously with stability and or complexity. Let me give you an example. People always say, and I get asked this question, is variability good or bad? And I say, well, it depends. What variability are you talking about? Okay. Let me give you an example also. People always say that if you have low stability, okay, variability should be low. If you're highly unstable, variability should be high. But that's not necessarily true. If you think about, I'll give you an example, an electrocardiogram, a heartbeat. Okay? Look at the tracing. It's well documented that in the healthier you are, the higher the variability. Okay? But also, if you look at that, the healthier you are, the stability is always the same. It's actually very low. It's a very, very stable system, but it has high variability. Of course, if you have low variability and stable in this particular case, you're really in serious trouble. So, you know, we have increased variability in stride to stride interval is often equated by a loss of gait stability. But that's not necessarily true. You know, if you look at the variability of the output, which is what a stride to stride variability is, it's actually the output or the endpoint variability. Okay. And we look at coordination variability emerging from the interactions of joint segments, it could be high. Okay. You'll always read that the stride to stride variability of an elderly person, okay, is very low. Okay. But their coordination variability could be high, or it could be low. Now, stability is not the same as variability. That's the first thing. And what we normally think of stability is a resistance to change. In dynamical systems, stability refers to a coordinative pattern's resilience to a change in response to a perturbation. Okay. It's a response to a perturbation. And you often see it talked about as measured by the variance from a preferred or attractor state, and that is what stability is, or the ability to rapidly return to the attractor state. You know, you can be perturbed and then come back. That's a measure of your stability. In postural control, stability talks about the maintenance of upright stance in response to an unexpected external or self-generated perturbations. One of the things that my colleague Richard Van Emmerich does, you know, everyone measures postural stability by having someone stand still like this. Well, you know, that's okay. But, you know, the perturbation that they use is eyes open or eyes closed. What Richard has done is use perturbations that are more natural, you know, like reaching for an object. You know, how you reach for the object and how you can return to a steady state. So there are more tasks of daily living that he uses rather than just standing still. And, you know, certainly individuals can fall, or that fall during minor perturbation could be categorized as unstable. Okay. But the difficult thing, it's difficult to determine the degree of stability when a system displays resilience to the perturbation. That's the difficult part. So, you know, we always talk about a stability boundary. Okay? And the stability boundary, if I'm standing here, is basically the area enclosed by my where my feet are. And usually you think from a purely mechanical point of view, as long as my center of mass is within the stability boundary, I will not fall. But that's really not quite true. If I'm standing here and I start to lean forward, my center of mass may be within my stability boundary, but I still may fall because it's moving too fast towards the boundary. And we often talk about global stability because it relates to the system's ability to maintain upright equilibrium, resisting large perturbations. And, you know, an example would be slipping on a low friction surface or tripping over an obstacle. And there are lots of techniques relating the center of mass to a stability boundary. And Pai and Bat used instantaneous position velocity, and Hoff and colleagues used a method called the margin of stability. In dynamical systems, only regarding the center of mass position in relation to the base of support we think is not enough. You have to take into consideration how fast the center of mass is moving to the boundaries, forward, backward, or side to side. And as I said, this, you know, the center of mass position in relation to the base of support is not enough. And the system could be highly unstable while the center of mass is within the base of support if the center of mass velocity is rapidly approaching the boundary. And of course, a system can become highly stable when the center of mass is outside the base of support if the center of mass velocity is in the direction approaching the center of mass. So, you know, if I'm in this position, my center of mass may be outside, but as long as I'm moving back towards my boundary, I could be very stable. And in the case of locomotion, this is what we do. You know, when you start walking, the center of mass leans out over the base of support, but then you catch it with the next step, and you're now within your base of support. So there's a method for calculating this called time to contact. And it actually is derived from a very, very famous study by a Scottish researcher, psychologist, and he looked at gannets. A gannet is a bird that flies and, you know, approaches the ocean and dives into the ocean, picks up fish, and then comes back out. But what the gannet does is it dives with its wings out, and at the very, very last second, it pulls its wings in and hits the water. If it hit the water with its wings like this, it would tear the wings off the bird, because they dive from very high heights. So this was sort of derived from that. It's not exactly equivalent, but it was sort of derived from that. Okay. So it's similar to the other stability boundary, stability measures, but it encompasses not only CO position, center mass position and velocity, but also adds in acceleration to determine if the velocity is increasing, decreasing, or remaining constant. And by adding this third dimension, it makes a big difference in the calculation. Okay. So, an instantaneous center of mass motion state, position of velocity, that is considered unstable, may in fact be stable if the magnitude and direction of the acceleration is sufficient. So this is an example of what we would do, and this is in a a postural sense. So the stability boundary is the boundary by the feet. The person is stable, just standing there. We give them a perturbation, and the center of mass goes like this. And what we do is we instantaneously measure how fast the center of mass is approaching the boundary. Okay? The perturbation was we pushed them from behind. And this is where the perturbation was given. And you can see all of the changes. So here, the center of mass is moving very fast towards the boundary, and then the person recovers. So what we use is the shortest possible time as an indicator of stability. Okay. The shortest possible time. So the person's pushed the shortest possible time that they have to stop the center of mass going outside the boundary and coming back in. And that is a measure of stability. Now there's also a measure of local, the time to contact is global stability. There's a local stability, and this is measured by a method called Lyapunov exponents. And this is a rather complicated method. It basically defines the system's sensitivity to small intrinsic perturbations. How well does the human locomotor system respond to naturally occurring fluctuations in gait? So if I'm walking along, you know, and then I stumble, How well do I respond to that? Or I slightly slip on the floor. How well do I respond to that? And these fluctuations can be a lot of things. They can be external or internal, maybe due to neuromotor noise or any other internal perturbations. You know, let's say you're wearing your headphones and you get a squeak in the headphones and it shakes you up for an instant. And basically what you have to do is attenuate the noise in order to maintain global stability. So, Lyapunov exponent measures local dynamic stability. And I am not going to explain to you all the details of Lyapunov exponent. It is rather complicated. I'll show you the process graphically though. What this measure does, it converts a signal from a time series to a phase space or state space. It determines the rates of convergence or divergence of nearby trajectories. In other words, nearby points. And what we look at is the trajectory refers to the small spatial path of the signal. So, and what it's looking at is the average rate or the slope of divergence on a log scale. So, the thing is with Lyapunov, there are assumptions. And you have to measure or take very, very great care in the assumptions. If you don't, then what you will get is nothing. It'll be garbage. Okay? And the problem is, there are a lot of papers published now in which they use Lyapunov exponents, but they don't have the right assumptions, and so the results are basically meaningless. One of the assumptions that you have in Lyapunov is you have what we call an embedding dimension, okay? And the number of data points that you need to confidently measure Lyapunov is 10 raised to the power of the embedding dimension. So let's say your embedding dimension is 5. That means you need 100,000 data points. So what that would mean is probably you have to collect, you know, 30 seconds or a minute of data sampling at over 100 hertz, which is not easy to do. And there's a benefit to this, an additional benefit, that's unlike traditional measures. Traditional measures treat each cycle as independent. Okay, Lyapunov evaluates the evolution of stability over the course of many strides, and that's very important because remember what a dynamical system is. And it can't really be equated by the overall stability variability in the system. Variability reflects something different. It reflects all variations of divergence and convergence, and it represents essentially different aspects of the system dynamics, while Lyapunov only addresses system divergence, how it changes. Again, there are a number of papers in the literature that use Lyapunov exponent and say we are measuring variability. But that's not quite true. So let me just graphically show you what happens. This is the original signal. And the signal is transformed into a higher level dimension state space by adding time delays. Okay? And the state space reveals neighboring trajectories. So you have all of these different trajectories over a period of time. And what Lyapunov does is it looks at the neighboring trajectories and assesses, are they diverging from each other? And then you plot this on a log-log scale and you measure the slope. So this is a long-term Lyapunov exponent, this is a short-term. That's basically what you're doing, okay? The higher the Lyapunov exponent, the less stable you are. The lower the Leopanov indicates that you're stable. Now there's another method that's called detrended fluctuation analysis, or DFA. And all you're doing with this is assessing the fractile nature of the signal. And, you know, there's a lot of studies that show stability or risk of fall in individuals. And it's not a very complicated analysis. It's just a root mean square analysis. And within each window, what the algorithm does is it fits a least square fit line. Okay. And the structure of the signal is then determined by a scaling component called alpha, which is the slope of a log-log plot of the DFA, or the detrended fluctuation analysis, for each window size. So a scaling of alpha equals 1 indicates what we call a 1 over F fractal-like long-range correlation. And this characterizes an optimal performance. So the closer you are to an alpha of 1, okay, that means that you're optimally performing and you're in a very stable state. Okay. So it indicates a long-term dependence across scales. And this is called fractal-like nature. And this 1 over F relationship, that is an alpha close to 1, or an alpha equals 1, is believed to represent a stable but a flexible system. And Jeffrey Hausdorff used DFA on stride time interval during locomotion. And he compared young adults, old adults, and adults with Huntington's disease. Are you familiar with Huntington's disease? Huntington's disease is very similar to, it is a disease where basically all the connections in the brain disappear and you lose control over a period of time, and eventually all the system shuts down. That's in a rough description, very rough. So what this showed is that Huntington's subjects exhibited more random behavior, while young adults exhibited more long-range correlations. So the young adults were close to an alpha of 1. The Huntington subjects were close to an alpha of 0.5. Now, stability. Now we go to complexity. And the thing about complexity is physiological processes occur over a number of spatiotemporal scales. They can occur over, you know, 1 second or 20 seconds, or a minute, or 2 minutes, or an hour. But what you have is you have a cooperative interaction among physiological processes, both within a short-term scale and between scales. And this gives rise to non-random structured behavior. And the newly emergent patterns constitute what we know as physiological complexity. Okay. So there's a complex way of doing things, and you have different ways, different time scales over which those occur, and different processes all interacting at the same time. And the system is maximally complex when the log of its power spectrum has a 1 over F with an alpha equals 1 structure. This is a long-range correlation. Okay. That is, the signal represents similar properties and correlation structures at different scales. So, if it's perfectly correlated, alpha equals 1. And alpha equals 0.5, the fluctuations are random with no correlation. We often say this is like white noise. And long-range correlations can be found between 0.5 and 1. If you have an alpha of 1.5, this means that you've integrated white noise, often called brown noise, with only short-range correlations. So it's not just a simple thing of looking at the alpha and then making the determination. Because sometimes you would think that an alpha of 0.75 would be the best of both worlds, but it's really not. Pink noise, long-range correlations, is a random process whereby the evolution over time is influenced by both the past and the present behavior. And it's hard to predict the exact evolution of the system, but distinct events based on probability can be predicted. What it really means is that no repeated movement will be performed exactly the same, but essential properties of the movement will be similar. This is almost like the coordinate of variability. Almost, not exactly the same. And this 1 over f structure is temporally correlated across many scales. So, let me give you an example of this. It's important to look at variability and complexity. So here the signal is variable, but not complex. Here what you have is a signal that is complex, but it's not variable. And here you have a system that is highly variable and is complex. You can have all of these combinations, and they all mean something different. One of the ways of looking at this is by a measure called entropy. And this comes from information theory. And information theory is based on quantifying uncertainty, and that's why entropy is a good measure for this. The control of human movement, the coordination adopted by the body and the trajectory of the desired movement, is sensitive to the initial conditions. And the problem is we seldom know what these initial conditions are. Okay. So there's uncertainty in our measurement. And the degree of uncertainty is measured by entropy. And this is the amount of information needed to describe a system generating the information. I'm not going to go through this, but it is developed from Kolmogorov Sinai complexity. And that's just the technique that all of this developed from. And what this entropy calculates is the mean rate of new information when measured given the history of the system. However, the kind of data to use this, it requires large data set that is noise free. And we very rarely get that. There are other methods called approximate entropy. This was developed from the previous entropy measure, and it's very, very commonly used. It allows calculations that contain noise, which is nice. And it's been used in postural control. It's been used in many, many, many different situations. And it basically shows that the more regular the pattern, the lower the approximate entropy value. That's nothing new. And the lower entropy means that it's less complex. And, you know, it produces basically inconsistent results. It's very sensitive to the length of the time series. The longer the time series, the better. Now, from approximate entropy was developed sample entropy. They're just variations on the theme. And it follows basically the same principles. It's been used to assess a lot of different things, from ACL injuries to lower limb angles in athletes. The thing about sample entropy, the KS entropy, and approximate entropy, they all use a time scale of 1. In other words, they evaluate the whole system, the whole signal. And that may be fine, except what happens if the entropy changes over the whole signal. So, multi-scale entropy was developed, and it has similarities to approximate sample entropy, but it essentially measures entropy over multiple time scales rather than one. And you remember that you have a lot of different structures in the human body that all interact with each other, and that can cause a change in the complexity. And so Magdalena Costa and her colleagues developed this multi-scale technique. And what it basically do is, it does this, you apply a number of different windows in time, and you calculate the sample entropy at each one of those windows. And the windows have to be non-overlapping, obviously. And the number of points being averaged inside the window is dependent upon the number of scale factors being used. Okay? You can't do, you can't collect a large sample. Usually what you have is the number of data points divided by, they suggest 4, but it could be any number. So this is what it looks like. And this actually came from Avelino Amato's master's thesis. And he was interested in drumming, but what he was doing was he was measuring the drumming and their postural stability. And so what he looks at, here he is, a time scale of 1, which is 12.5 milliseconds, and a time scale of 150, factor 12, with 150 milliseconds. And you can see that while standing on 1 foot and standing on 2 feet, the complexity changes over time. And this is very important, because if you did this with a time scale of 1, you would get the same values. Okay. And of course, what we can do is calculate the area under the curve, and this tells us the overall complexity of the system. It's a very, very nice tool. Lastly, adaptability. They're all associated with adaptability, variability, stability, and complexity. A highly stable system, okay, is very difficult to perturb. Transitioning or adapting to a new constraint or behavioral state may be very challenging. And movement variability can play a role in destabilizing these patterns. Increased variability are also essential features. Okay. What happens when you are walking and you walk faster and faster and faster and eventually start running is the variability, coordinated variability, increases. And it increases until you start running and then it drops down to a lower level. So the variability is indicating when you make the transition. Okay. And a feature of the phase transition is an appearance of fluctuations. And the fluctuations are characterized by an increase in variability, okay, and a large increase in time it takes to recover from the disturbance to steady state. Enhancement of fluctuations in complex systems arise due to influence of elements at a more microscopic level. Variability occurs at a macroscopic, complexity a more microscopic level. And all of these, the microscopic level and the environmental fluctuations and coordination variability, pull the system away from its current stable state. Okay. And fluctuations around the transition point are observed in things like bimanual finger coordination, walk-to-run transition, and coordination between the arms and legs in human walking and running. So you can see that these observations make it clear there's a link between the stability of coordinated pattern and the ability of the system to transition to a new state. So a coordinated state that is too stable and resistant to perturbations may not be the most optimal system for adaptability. Okay. And it appears that this 1 over F scaling is the best mix of the system dynamics. That is, an alpha equals 1 in terms of complexity. So what are the conclusions? Even though those concepts are related, you can't interchange them. You can't use stability to measure variability. You can't use complexity to say a system is stable. You know, you can't say complexity is variability. They're all related. Okay. Variability of a system and coordinated variability may relate to global measures of movement, stability, and complexity, but they're not the same thing. And, you know, local dynamic stability, using Lyapunov, it can reveal local instabilities, but it doesn't tell you much about the global pattern of stability. So, observed reductions in local dynamic stability measured here will require testing as to how these reductions impact resistance to change, which is stability. So methods DFA, Lyapunov, various entropy, they're indicative of what the system is doing. And what you have to do is empirical research from a dynamical systems perspective, and it should provide a strong rationale and comparative argument for using certain analysis techniques over others. In other words, the technique that you want to measure, you should use the appropriate measuring technique. Okay? If you want to measure variability, don't use Lyapunov or don't use entropy. Okay. That's the gist of this whole talk, actually. And I would like to thank you for your attention. And again, I'll show photos of the University of Massachusetts. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. Thank you. Tiago? Oh, here, take this one.
Joe, in your opinion, is it possible to use Lyapunov applied to electromyography?
Theoretically, you could use it for any biological or any signal. Okay, some signals would be much more difficult to do, because remember, two things that you need for Lyapunov is you need a time delay, and you need an embedding dimension. And for many signals, you don't know what those are. And so what you have to do, and what we had to do, was basically a sensitivity analysis. In other words, you manipulate the time delay and see what various time delays actually, how it affects the system, and then the embedding dimension and how it affects the system. So it's not a very simple thing to do. What a lot of people do, which, you know, is fine, I guess, is go to the literature and they say, Tiago et al. Used an embedding dimension for locomotion of 5. So that's what I'll use. And he used an embedding dimension, say, of 20 milliseconds. So that's what I'll use. You know, that's okay, you can do that. And it's legitimate, but I prefer to find these things out for myself on my data. And that's a long process. And one of the things I should mention too, there are two methods of using Lyapunov exponents or calculating them. One is called the Wolf method, with very, very, very strict assumptions. The other one is called the Rosenstein method, which loosens up the assumptions a little bit. The Rosenstein is used for short duration Lyapunov. Wolf requires the long duration Lyapunov. And we presented a paper that showed for the Rosenstein method, you need probably about 5,000 data points, whereas Wolf says you need 100,000. You know, somewhere between 5 and 10,000, you can be pretty confident using Rosenstein. But I've never done EMG, and I really don't know anyone who has.
Thank you, Joe, for your presentation. Again, it was very insightful, so thank you very much, really. We appreciate. Well, I don't have a strict question, but yesterday you mentioned that when you submitted an application for a grant, and it was a dynamical system approach some years ago, it was not well accepted because the area was still growing and still initiating these concepts. So my first question is, what is your diagnostic, okay? Mm-hmm. What do you think that today, where we are in the terms of nonlinear analysis and movement knowledge? To understand movement with nonlinear tools, where we are?
That's a really good question. I think nonlinear dynamics and dynamical systems are much more better received now than they were when I first started off. I wrote that paper with Richard in 1990. Well, actually, I wrote it in 1998. It was published in 1999 about the high and low variability and how it relates to pathology. And immediately, we submitted a grant in 2000, 2001, and people just didn't accept it. I think if we did the same thing now, it would be much more received. Now, motor control has been using dynamical systems a lot longer than biomechanics, and it depends who reviews it. If it's a motor control person, they would view it much more favorably if the question was good in itself. That's the important thing. And I think biomechanists now, because a lot more people are especially viewing coordination variability, a lot more people are using coordination variability in biomechanics. And what's interesting, we developed a couple of different methods for measuring coordination variability. One was called continuous relative phase, and the other one was called a modified vector coding approach. And in the clinical world, most of the people use the modified vector coding. In biomechanics, I would probably use more continuous relative phase. One is a higher dimensional state space than the other. But one is easier to interpret than the other. So I think more people understand that now. The entropy measures and the Lyapunov exponent measures are not as well understood. In other words, the complexity and the stability measures are not as well understood, in biomechanics at least, anyway.
Yes, John, I have the same point of view, and I asked this because I think that the problem with this, for example, motor control, that is my area, is that when you have a clear physiological meaning of what you are measuring, it's okay and it's very nice and it's amazing, really. But these techniques are increasingly being used, and sometimes we simply don't have any idea what does that mean physiologically? For example, the pioneering paper by Collins and De Luca, which they did the Randall walk analysis and postural control model, and they tried similar to your short range correlations and long term correlations. And then when you try to associate this with a closed loop control system and an open loop control system, without any support of a physiological effect, I think that that is the problem. Not the tool they are using, but the physiological meaning they are trying to attribute to the tool. And this is just one example, and not to criticize them, that Peterka published a paper years later using a model and saying that we can have the same pattern without in a system that was not built to show a closed loop behavior. Okay, another example, it should be confidential, so I'm not going to give you details, but recently I reviewed a paper for EBR, and that they were trying to look at H reflexes as a temporal series variability of peak to peak amplitude of H reflexes, and trying to make a fractal analysis. That's okay. But then when you see that between two conditions we change the alpha from 0.5 to 0.57, and it is statistically significant, okay? But then we say that we change from a white noise to a brown noise, and we try to imagine what this means physiologically. The authors could not convince me, and neither did the other reviewer. So I think that we should first understand the physiological meaning of, and it's very task specific and depends on the kind of the movement we are looking to. I don't know, I'm saying all this to ask what is your opinion. I'm giving your opinion and for you to talk.
Well, I agree with you completely. Anybody could do these calculations. You know, the calculations, you can look on the internet and you'll find a computer program that will do any of these calculations. The trick is to give physiological meaning to the results. Okay. And in many instances, it's up to you to give some physiological meaning to the results when you write the paper and use these techniques. Then the next thing that you have to do is show that your interpretation is the correct interpretation. And so you do future studies to try and predict what you initially said originally. Now, as I said in this 1999 paper, I had a little bit of data on patellofemoral pain and healthy controls. We did not have a lot of data, but I did the analysis on coordination variability. And what I noticed was the patellofemoral pain people had lower coordination variability than the people who were healthy. So I made the assumption then that lower coordination variability indicated a pathology. And then I made the leap and it said maybe it is also an indicator of the potential for a pathology. And what I further said in the paper was that the reason why people have lower coordination variability when they have a pathology or the potential for a pathology is that they have fewer degrees of freedom. And in terms of the pathology, they may in fact be of trying to avoid pain by adopting a more or a less variable coordinative response.
They're more constrained.
More constrained. I just said that. I had no proof except for these few little, you know, I think we only had 5 subjects in each group. And, you know, I just put it out there. And lucky for me, that it turned out in later studies that we did, that was true. And not only, well, at least the lower variability is associated with pathology, not the pain part. And luckily for me that a number of other researchers did the same thing and got the same results. So we can be pretty confident, not 100% sure, but we've been confident that further studies have supported. So what you have to do is you have to do a study with a particular method and make an interpretation of the data, okay, as best you can, and you know, in terms of some physiological response, and then publish it, and then hopefully other people will do this similar studies, and you should do similar studies as well to show that that is in fact true. Okay, and that is, I call that the art of science.
Yes.
You know, and it's not an easy thing to do.
Challenging.
Yeah, and it's also, you know, sometimes you will get people saying that you're absolutely dumb and silly. But you have to put it out there. You have to hang out there, and you know, whatever happens, happens. You know, I keep saying to myself, I'm thankful that someone read my paper and actually wanted to do something along the same lines. But right now, coordination variability, especially in clinical work, is almost the norm that people are using. And there are thousands of studies now that use that concept. And it's been very robust so far, the interpretation. The one thing about the part that has not been robust and really has not been looked at is pain. You know, we think that the higher the pain level, the lower the variability, but that has never been shown. Okay, so actually we're talking about doing some studies on pain and coordination variability.
Very interesting. Well, thank you, Joe. Well, last one, much more specific,
sure,
less philosophical. I was curious in our presentation about the time to contact on the center of mass. Is this non-linear or a linear measure?
It actually, you know, that's a really good question. It's a linear measure. It is a linear measure. We consider it non-linear because it's a measure of stability. But you're right, it is a non-linear, or it is a linear measure. And what can I say? It is a linear measure.
Okay. Thank you.
Joe, some friends from the Federal University of Goiás watching you now. And they make a question, step length and step frequency variability could be considered endpoint or coordinative variability?
Step length, okay, or stride rate or anything like, those are endpoint. Those are dictated by the coordination pattern. What you would expect in healthy individuals, that the step length variability should be relatively low, okay? But the coordination variability should be relatively high, okay? In other words, there are many ways of accomplishing the same step length if you changed the coordination patterns, and you can, okay? And this is a problem because, you know, in the literature, I think I said this during the talk and I was incorrect, that people have shown that as you age, the step length variability increases, and I think I said decreases in the talk. As you age, it increases. And they say that as step length variability in the elderly increases, that you become less stable. That doesn't make sense, because one is measuring an outcome without looking at the coordination and without looking at stability itself. Okay?
Joe, thank you again for the presentation, very nice one. And in line with Fernando's question, when you say variability, stability, complexity, you are putting numbers to measure motor control or human movement. Is there any of these numbers that you see is the more promising in order to practical stuff, like you get a kid training, young sports boy, and can you predict if the training is doing well for him or he's improving his skills, or if you go to the laborers, it's time to go back to the to the work, or it's time to stay out of the work? Is there any of these numbers that you see, this is the one that we should focus on and put it forward in order to try to bring real stuff with these numbers?
Yeah, that's a good question too. And I guess I can start off by saying it depends upon your question. What are you interested in terms of, let's say you have a young athlete, okay, and you want to see, is this athlete becoming more skilled? Well, one of the things that you can do in terms of variability is determine skill level fairly easily. Because the higher the skill level, the higher the coordination variability will be. You know, when a person starts learning the skill, the coordination variability is very high because they really don't know what to do. Okay? As the person becomes more skilled, the variability actually decreases because they're freezing the degrees of freedom. As they become even more skilled, the degrees of freedom, the potential degrees of freedom and variability increases, coordination variability. So there are two things you could do with a young athlete. Measure the coordination variability. If it's relatively high, that's a good thing. And then measure their endpoint variability. Can they achieve the goal? So that's one way, and you could put a number to that. Okay? You know, in terms of a clinical situation, you can measure both global stability and local stability very easily. And we know, for example, in terms of Lyapunov, the higher the Lyapunov exponent, the less stable the system. Okay. The time to contact can also be used. Okay. So these numbers mean something. But as you said before, you have to assign a physiological response to each one of these numbers. And if you don't know what the numbers mean, you can't do that. Okay? Generating the number is easy. Interpreting it is a little bit more difficult. And that's where, you know, you as a scientist become a better scientist by being able to assign a physiological process to a number. And whether that physiological process is good, bad, or indifferent to a specific number.
Do you know any group work on that, bringing up these numbers? Let's say, because when I teach to the undergrad, I always say, well, you whether can be a researcher or a consumer of research. Most of you must be a consumer of research. Is there any group putting these numbers in order to be consumed by the
coaches? I mean, I think I've done that, and I think a number of other people have done that. you know, there's my colleague Richard has done a number of studies on, you know, postural control and use time to contact. I've used time to contact. Jeff Haddad, one of Richard's former students, has used both time to contact and another technique which I didn't discuss today called recurrence quantification analysis, and put a number on a child's ability to maintain an upright posture and fit objects through different apertures. So yeah, there's lots of numbers that are there and lots of interpretations to these numbers. And hopefully, you know, the people that consume research can understand what these numbers mean. But initially, you have to assign a number to the state of the physiological process, and that's the hard part.
Any further question?
Moshizuki.
One from Luis.
Yes.
There's a question from Luis Moshizuki. As you said in your presentation, gate embedded dimension is about 5, right?
The so embedding dimension, yes.
Yes.
For Lyapunov.
Yes. So he asks, how can we associate this dimension with the several degrees of freedom that we have in our lower limbs during gait? And if does that mean that at least all degrees of freedom will be coupled to these 5 big clusters?
No, no, it doesn't mean that at all. And I hate to say this, but Luis is making the classical mistake in trying to associate a Lyapunov exponent of stability with what's happening, variability, for example, in the lower extremity. Usually, with the Lyapunov, it's a measure, one measure that represents everything. And usually we use, you know, the center of mass, okay? And of course, the center of mass you can manipulate very easily by changing the orientation of the different limbs. So the embedding dimension simply means at how many levels of dimension you're going to raise the state space to. Okay, so you know if we do a parameter time, okay, that's a dimension really of 1. So if you go to velocity and angle, you're doing a higher dimension state space. If you go acceleration, velocity, you're even higher state space. So you go up a number of state spaces and you find for locomotion, it's generally 5 state spaces that you have to have.
How can we determine this? This is a magical number?
No, it's not. You basically have to. And I can tell you what we did is we started off with a dimension, a state space, an embedding dimension of 2. And we saw how that affected the system. So then we go to a dimension, a state space of 3 and see how that affects the system. Eventually we got to 5 and we saw how that affected the system. And then we went to 6. And we saw that an embedding dimension of 6 did not affect the system any differently than 5 did. So we said it's 5.
Such as defining a polynomial to fit something, okay.
Yeah, it's a similar process. It's like a sensitivity analysis is what you're doing. And you do the same thing with the, what we did was once we found the, time delay first, and then we did the embedding dimension with the time delay that we thought was the best. A lot of it is trial and error, you know. And as I said to Tiago earlier, the easiest thing to do is to look up in the literature and see what everyone else used. And if you're doing a similar movement, use their results. You know, that's acceptable, but I prefer to do it myself. And our lab prefers to, you know, the person that has become an expert on is Scott Ducharme, one of the, he's a doctoral student of Richards, and his knowledge of Lyapunov now far exceeds my knowledge of Lyapunov. Maybe not Richards' knowledge, but it certainly exceeds my knowledge. So. It's just one of those processes.
Okay.
Thank you.
More questions? Joe, thank you again for the very nice presentation and to answer all these questions. And thank you for everyone that's watching us. Yesterday, I told you we had 1,000 connections to your presentation. Maybe we have even more now today. I'll check the numbers. And as everyone is invited for the afternoon presentation that's going to take place at the same place at 2 o'clock p.m. Thank you and see you later.
Yeah, this afternoon is on how to write a manuscript. Thank you.